So hello everyone, welcome. I don't have a clicker. So if you could help, yeah, that'd be great. Thank you, Hopewell. We are going to start our new series today. It's a new series on the Holy Spirit. And I'm really grateful for all of us to be here together as we talk about the Holy Spirit, because I think we have a profound question that we'll be talking about for the next 4 weeks. It's who is the Holy Spirit? Who's the Holy Spirit? Now, those of us that might have some knowledge about Christianity might know, oh, me. It's a third person of the Trinity. And you'd be right. Good job. Gold star. Maybe some other people would say it's an impersonal force that's involved, you know, in a religion or religions. We can maybe say that the Spirit is the intangible element of Christianity that people don't really understand but continue to include because they have to. Let's just be real about that. Sometimes that's the way it can come across. But truth be told, the Spirit of God, does operate in a different mode than Jesus, than God the Creator. The Spirit's often characterized as imperceptible, but present. In fact, the Spirit of God, is closer than our very breath. But when people or things are close to you, you don't always understand them, right? You know this sometimes in your families, maybe some of you guys in your marriage. People that are close to you, sometimes you don't get them exactly, right? Just, again, being real. That's often the case with the Holy Spirit. And during this series, we're going to look at the Holy Spirit through the Gospel of John, through John's witness. John records an audacious statement from Jesus. And it's Jesus saying that it's better for him to go. It's better for Jesus to leave this earth than to stay, because it's better for the Holy Spirit to come. And Jesus would leave, the Holy Spirit would come. He says, it's actually better for that to happen than for me to stay among you. Now, to me, that seems absolutely ridiculous. Like, maybe you guys are like me, you've had some experience following Jesus, struggled with that quite a bit, and you're like, actually, Jesus in the flesh sounds like a really good deal. Like, sometimes I wonder, you know, what would Jesus do? Not necessarily the bracelet kind of way, but just kind of like, I wonder, what would Jesus be up to? And if he was up to something in New Haven, couldn't I just follow him? Like, literally follow him, like, never leave his side. Like, I would have to figure out how, like, food would work, bathroom breaks, but, like, not losing sight of the man so I could be doing the things that Jesus is doing. But Jesus says, no, actually, there's something better. It's actually better for him to go and for the Spirit to come. That, to me, seems crazy. But I think Jesus might know what he's talking about. The very first way, I think, is that Jesus, when he leaves that imprint of going from place to place, meeting person to person, town to town, and he's replaced with a Spirit that can be everywhere, that can be in anyone. The Spirit's now permeating our world, imperceptible, but present. The Holy Spirit's involved in our lives, giving us courage. The Holy Spirit is involved in helping us recognize beauty in the world around us. The Holy Spirit is involved in securing justice, in seeking the peace of the city, like we've been talking about. The Holy Spirit's involved in our parenting, our jobs, our families, our romantic relationships. The Holy Spirit is in there with us, involved in all facets of our lives. Yet we often don't notice the Holy Spirit, or we aren't aware of the Holy Spirit. That doesn't prevent the Spirit from being the Spirit to us. That's really good. That's really helpful. Us not being aware of the Spirit doesn't prevent the Spirit from being the Spirit. The Spirit provides us with the very breath of life. This awareness of the Spirit's presence can happen in quiet ways, taking a walk, understanding or trusting again or for the first time that God is good, that this world is beautiful, even when it doesn't seem like it, it's beautiful, and that we have a role to play in it all. But it can also happen in maybe in less calm, less kind of quaint ways. It can be somewhat dramatic. A few of us at Elm City Vineyard went to a conference this weekend in New Jersey. It's a conference where they're focusing on more love and more power, the role of the Holy Spirit's presence in our lives. And was cool what we saw there and what we experienced. One of the things that we did as an exercise was to ask for the Spirit of God to come, to have a kind of a crowd of people, kind of like this, maybe less people. Just ask, Spirit of God, would you just come into the room? And we waited. If you read scripture, you know there's a long history of commands of wait for the Lord. Be strong, take courage, wait for the Lord. And there's a sense of when you wait that things actually happen. And that's what we saw, imperceptible at first, but present to us. People receiving a spirit of peace, just feeling like there's a stillness over them. They didn't just seem like quiet or people were like rustling less, but more that there was something that was happening, people experiencing peace. Some people started to cry, to kind of release sadness or release burdens, like some sighing in the room. And then people started to stand up, to say, I'm feeling the Spirit's presence. They wanted to receive prayer. And eventually, at the end of that time, the room was full of activity. No one had asked them to be that active, but the Spirit of God seemed to kind of motivate them to get up, to cry out, to pray for others. The room was changed because of the work of the Holy Spirit. It started off imperceptible, like a little mustard seed, right? But then it grew. It grew. And one of the teens that was with us, because we brought some teens, which was crazy. I may or may not tell you stories later. That teen said, this was the most amazing thing I have ever seen in my life. Seeing people, and probably specifically adults, like touched by God in a way that they actually reacted. He's like, I didn't know it was this real. Short life, but like for a kid, that's a pretty powerful thing to say, right? They probably watch a lot of movies, a lot of fun things. Like, no, this is the most amazing thing. Now, who knows? Maybe the next day he said about something else. But that seemed to be a powerful statement at the time. Later on that night, we were in another time of prayer ministry. And this time there was a call for praying for women and praying for people over 50. And the speaker just felt like those groups had been unseen, kind of rejected in ways. And they said, let's actually pray and spend time to pray for those people, women and people over 50. And so as I was trying to pray for people, I noticed people were kind of covered. The conference had warmed up by this point, so people were like trying to pray for people. It was great. I was like, I don't really have someone to pray for. I tried to look for mentors that I knew in the vineyard, couldn't find them, or if I found them, people were already swarmed and praying with them. And I said, I don't know really what to do. Let me just kind of ask the Spirit just to check in. And I felt kind of like, look behind you. Like, see who's not up at the front. See who didn't go up. And I look, and there's this woman who has a cane, is kind of hunched over. And I'm like, oh, that kind of makes sense, right? It was a call for 50 and above. Maybe someone, like one of them, wouldn't be able to rush to the front and get prayer. Right? There's a Bible story, I think, about that, right? There was a sense that she was kind of left behind. And I just went up to her. I said, hey, can I pray for you? She said, yes. And then she said something that kind of took me by surprise. She said, this is all really new to me. She was in her 60s. I was like, oh, wow. Like, I kind of thought maybe if she had been there, if she's at a conference, this would be familiar, old hat. She's like, no, this is all really new. I didn't know that God could look like this, that the Spirit could look like this. And I said, can I pray for you? And she said, yes. I'd really like to experience what other people are experiencing right now. And also, by the way, I have this back condition. I have spinal arthritis. And, you know, this guy's talking about healing and Jesus healing and Jesus is healing in scripture. So I want to pray about that if that's okay. I was like, yeah, it's okay. Let's pray. And so we prayed together. And I could tell, again, that something was happening, imperceptible at first, but then it started to appear, this peace that kind of appeared over her. She felt calm. She was kind of nervous and more anxious as she was talking to me before, but now she was actually experiencing, I think, more peace. Then she actually started to cry, to tear up. And then I asked, what are you feeling? She said, I just feel God's presence. I feel peace. I was like, that's good. More of that, God. And then I asked, can I pray for that sickness, the back pain? And she's like, okay. And then I prayed for it, and then I kind of said, well, what's going on with you? What's happening now? That might seem like a weird question, but again, this is all new to her. So I think the kind of religious prayer where you say like, hey, like, gonna pray for your sickness, done, amen, let's go on our way. That probably would be more confusing than having prayer and kind of checking in and saying, so I know it's new to you, so what did you experience? You know, are you still in pain? And so I asked her, and she said, well, actually, I can't really feel any right now. I was like, do you mind standing up and just seeing if there's any other pain in your body? And so she stood up, she said, oh yeah, no, there's pain right here, there's pain right here, it's kind of this pinching pain. I said, do you mind if I pray one more time? And so we did, and another person had joined me at this point. So we prayed one more time, and I asked, what's happening with the pain? She's like, the pain's actually gone, like it's not there anymore. And that's an amazing thing that God can do through the Spirit. And I don't know what happened to her. I don't know what happened to her condition. I think when you pray for people, especially when you pray for healing, you should never overestimate what happened. But all I know is that there was pain she was experiencing in the moment that was no longer happening at the end of our prayer time. I don't know anything else other than that. And then I asked, well, are you connected to this church? She said, yeah. And I said, just keep being connected here. Keep being connected to this family and keep praying for the Spirit of God to come into your life. You said it's new for you, but I don't think it has to be over today. She seemed to appreciate that message and that word. The Holy Spirit's involved in our lives in a close way. There's something going on with her physically, but also there's something going on mentally and spiritually. The Holy Spirit's involved in all parts of our lives. It can happen in quiet ways and dramatic ways. Like it can happen with that teen, very young. It can happen with that woman on the older side. It can happen in tangible ways like that woman felt, but for that teen, he didn't really see. Nothing really changed with him. He just saw something different, right? He noticed something. He became aware. It was intangible for him, but it was still real. But there was the same result at the end of the day for both of them, more life. More life they saw, more life that they felt, more life that they were engaged in, life from the Spirit. The breath of life, the breath of the Spirit animates us with life and makes the invisible presence of God known to us. The breath of life facilitates encounters with God and life-giving encounters with others. In this series, we're exploring the Holy Spirit's role in bringing the breath of life that will fill us up with more of the Spirit and more life. And that's life that we can enjoy ourselves, life that we can share with others. It's life everlasting that the Holy Spirit brings. So who is the Holy Spirit is a great question. And we can also ask the question, Holy Spirit, who are you to me? Holy Spirit, the Spirit that I think is present in this room, who are you to me? Are you my help? Are you my friend? Are you distant? Are you strange? We can ask that question. We can even ask Holy Spirit, what are you up to in this room? So I'm going to take this time to pray for us and to ask just that. Holy Spirit, who are you to us, the body of ECV? What are you doing in this room right now? Holy Spirit, would you be present with us as we continue teaching about who you are? It's kind of a vulnerable thing to do, teach about you in front of you, but we're kind of committing that that's what happens, right? That you're here, that you're present to us and to our stories. God, especially if that's a difficult thing for people this day and this weekend, this year, ask that you would give them courage and help to engage. We trust that you're with all of us. So we pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. Today we're going to walk through three parts of John's narrative and kind of set up our time together in this series. It's going to be a way to orient us for the rest of our time. We're going to look at three parts of Scripture where the Spirit brings life to creation, where the Spirit brings life to Jesus, where the Spirit brings life to the church. Creation, Jesus, and the church. And we'll start with John, and his gospel begins in a very familiar place. It begins, in the beginning. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. It's kind of a poetic phrase that happens in the beginning. I think these words resonate with Genesis, the book of beginnings, which is something John seems to want his audience to understand, to connect with. The story of John connecting to the big story of creation. And at the beginning, we see the Spirit of God already at work. The Spirit's not only present everywhere, but also has been before and will be again. The Spirit's present for all of time. And the first mention of the Spirit in the Bible is actually in Genesis, first chapter and second verse. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. This language seems to fit maybe a broken understanding of what we have for the Spirit. Far off, mysterious, hovering at a distance. We might even mistake formless as a word for the Spirit, instead of as one for the land, right? It's not the Spirit that's formless, it's actually the land. But it's easy, at least in my mind, to mistake those things. I mean, I think this way is somewhat prevalent in our thinking, whether you're a follower of Jesus or not, when you think of spiritual things, that they're just beyond our grasp. They glint and gleam from far off, they spark in our imagination, but then they hover away. They're gone. That spiritual moment is over. We became close to God or the things of God, but we didn't quite get a hold like we wanted to. It wasn't as tangible as we were hoping for. And life can feel that way when we think about spiritual things. I think religion can feel that way. Maybe even things here at Elm City Vineyard feel that way for you. I sense the Spirit in this place when we come together, but I can't grasp it completely. When I leave, I just don't know how to engage that again. But it's important to know that's not the full creation account. That's actually just where the story begins. In fact, the Spirit's present in creation in another way. Scripture tells the story of creation that shows God's activity to bring life to creation through the Spirit. And we see that in Genesis 2, this other way of telling the story as it continues. Now, no shrub had yet appeared on the earth, and no plant had yet sprung up, for the Lord God had not sent rain on the earth, and there was no one to work the ground. But streams came up from the earth and watered the whole surface of the ground. Then the Lord God formed a man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living being. Here we see a full version, a complete version of the Spirit's activity. Instead of just hovering over a formless void, we see the Spirit more active, more influential. In fact, the word for Spirit is so active that it's translated to breathe, to breath. That's what it is in Hebrew. In Greek, it's sometimes translated as wind. It's active Spirit, an engaged Spirit. The Lord God took formless dust and animated it, so it became life, all of humanity. Now, when I think about this, there's even like a need here that you see. There's a need for someone to work the ground. And you know when people, you know, find a need, maybe especially like a parental figure, it doesn't always come across as intimate as like getting to the ground and forming and taking the dust. Like when my dad wanted a remote control that was somewhere in the house, right? It never had a certain location, but it was somewhere. He didn't like go and help me find and like form me with it. He's like, just get the remote control. Get it. We see God here has a need. He needs someone to work the land. But he doesn't just say, okay, man, do it. Okay, humanity, go for it. But he actually goes to the ground. He goes low, and he forms. It's intimate. There's this breath of life. It's almost like a kiss of creation. That's different than when we usually have a need in our life or when someone has a need for us. There's something real and personal. This Spirit animates all of humanity. This isn't for one group and not another. It's not for one religious group and not another, right? It's all of humanity. That's what Genesis dares to believe, is this animation, this spiritual breath actually animates all of us as humans, that our humanity fundamentally carries with it the breath of the Spirit. Where there is something formless, the Spirit brings it into shape with care, with creativity, with power. The Spirit provided the breath of life and creation, and the Spirit continues to shape formless things and to bring life anew to things that are dead, to things that are dying, to things that are lifeless. The Spirit's engaged, breathing life anew. Humanity's already been created, but the Spirit is still birthing acts of creativity and animating life with the Spirit's presence all the time, everywhere. One of the most powerful moments of encounter I've had with the Holy Spirit didn't take place in a church, didn't take place at a conference, it actually didn't even take place in America. It was in Ghana, on the beach, the Atlantic Ocean, at night. Some of you guys have heard me tell one part of this story. Going to Ghana, studying the transatlantic slave movement. Going there as a student, as a 22-year-old, 21 actually, now that's important to you, and being there, being overwhelmed. I've told a particular story, seeing the slave castle and seeing the church inside and just being devastated. But then going up past the church, up to the top, looking at the sky and looking at an ocean that actually was a story not just of death but of survival, and praising God, the living God, that isn't inhabited only in a church, especially a church like that, but is inhabited in his people, people that he protects, that he saves, that he redeems. And at the end of that trip, there was kind of a one last stop. I think people wanted to go to kind of a cliffside bar before going to the airport. And some of us were like, okay, we're going to definitely go to the bar. And other people were like, this is like the Atlantic Ocean. This is our last night here. Of course, let's just go to the rocks. And so I went to the cliff, went down, got as far as I could on the rocks, and just kind of perched myself on a rock, just kind of crouching down low, putting my hands out. ECV wasn't even formed as a church yet, and I was engaging in practice. I would learn even more at this church. I don't even know if it was a prayer that I was praying, but I just looked out into the dark. I looked out into what was formless to me, and I looked at the chaos that is my story as a Black American, and I felt the depths of that. I experienced the depths of that. But then this chaos became a little rhythmic, and I'm sure the water helped as the water lapped in and out. The wind came this way and that way. And all of a sudden, I found myself in prayer. And I found myself feeling a presence. Some of you guys have had this experience sometimes where you close your eyes and you feel like, it feels like someone's near me. I kind of open my eyes. No, I don't see anyone. That happened a few times. But it felt like someone was with me. To the point where even when I had my outstretched arms, I know that sounds weird, and my outstretched hands, but I felt like there was a presence that was embracing my hands. And I was like, this is really weird. But also, I really needed it. Has that ever happened where there's something strange where you're like, I actually needed that strange thing. I needed to be gripped in that moment. That chaos needed to become shaped. The formless thing needed to become formed. And the Spirit, because I think it was the Spirit, didn't give me like these great answers. But the Spirit gave me the Spirit's presence. The Spirit was with me in a deep way, in a profound way, in a moment I'll always remember. I was there at the Atlantic Ocean on the other side for the first time. And who was with me? The Spirit of God. That's a Spirit that can recreate memories, that can rewrite stories, even stories of death, of dying, or of lifelessness. The Spirit isn't just present at creation. The Spirit's also present in the life of Jesus. We see this in Jesus' life. Actually, the first time we see the Spirit's presence, it's not at a healing, it's not at a deliverance, it's Jesus getting baptized. We're going to look I'm going to look at this story real quick. The next day, John the Baptist saw Jesus coming toward him and declared, "Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, 'After me comes a man who ranks ahead of me, because he was before me.' I myself did not know him, but I came baptizing with water for this reason, that he might be revealed to Israel." And John testified, "I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it remained on him. I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water said to me, 'He on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit.' And I myself have seen and testified that this is the Son of God." This is the writer of this text talking about John the Baptist, another John. There's a lot of Johns. But John's witness to this baptism. And what had Jesus done? What had Jesus accomplished? Nothing at this time. He just was Jesus. But there was this chosenness, this belovedness, the Spirit descending. Right? If anyone could go up and get something from the Spirit, right, it'd be Jesus. But Jesus himself doesn't. He waits for this moment of blessing, and the Spirit descends. There's a descending Spirit. I think a lot of us here might struggle with what it means to climb upward, what it means to try to achieve something yourself. Again, if anyone could have done that, it would have been Jesus. But Jesus waits. Jesus rests. Jesus lets the Spirit descend on him. Where do you find your life? Is it in peace that allows rest and remaining? It doesn't just descend, but it remains, right? Or do you find your life, or what we call our lives, in toil that demands labor and constant movement? The Spirit was actually coming and offering life to Jesus, but it wasn't life that was based on performance or achievement, but it's simply life that was about what it means to be loved and beloved, what it means to step into a moment. This moment was baptism for Jesus, where Jesus said, "I love you." And the Spirit descended. Do we find our rest there? Do we find it in labor and constant movement? As a pastor, I struggle with this all the time. And I get pretty embarrassed about how it happens because it just, I feel like it's more embarrassing for me. Getting anxious about big events like Society of Vineyard Scholars Conference or maybe our 10th anniversary, hoping that they'll go a certain way, struggling with fears that they will go a different way. Even though the entire existence of the event is about God's faithfulness, right? If God wasn't faithful, that wouldn't happen in the first place. this is the confusion that it is to be me, and people maybe that are involved in ministry just know how silly it is, but how much it can consume us. Sometimes it's the false trust that my constant movement to do good work, I think this isn't just a pastoral problem, but some of us have this too, our constant movement to do good work, whether it's for our friends, whether it's for our family, that it'll somehow like auto-populate, like kind of a text thing, the right amount of rest and stillness in our lives. Like, well, if I do some good this day, of course my sleep will just be magical. It's like, that's not always how it works. It's the way I want it to work, but it just doesn't seem to be the case. So we try to justify this constant movement with this good thing we'll experience, and we find ourselves still being tired, overworked, feeling this labor. Lately, it's been a few existential moments I've had where I've maybe been wearing a backpack, had something in my left hand, something in my right hand, I'm trying to get into my door, and then I think about, wait, in a month and a half, I won't just have these things in my hand, I'll have a child, and I can't do at all what I'm doing right now, and this is crazy. How will I do this? I actually don't know. And I'm kind of overcome with the thought of like, I don't know how I'll do anything. And then I'm like, well, the baby's not here yet, so I guess I can still like put the thing down, open the door. But then I think again, like, but what will I do then? And I still don't know. Maybe I'll put the baby in the backpack, but that doesn't seem like it'd be a good idea. I think Tina probably would get a little bit mad at that. And that's funny, yes, but there become like kind of a different conversation I have. Like, how will I do this? Will I be a good parent? Will I be a good anything else if I am a good parent? If I will be that? In those moments, I need to take a breath, a deep one. And maybe you all need to do the same when you think about your commitments, when you think about the standards of evaluation that you use or that other people use against you. Maybe it's the expectations that you have. Maybe it's the expectations of your parents or others. I think we need to take a breath together to breathe in, to breathe out. Slowly. And in that slowing down, the baptism of Jesus reminds me that the Spirit descended. There wasn't something Jesus achieved or accomplished to get it, but he actually just rested in the activity of God, the activity of the Father. And it was done by the Spirit descending. That same life is available to us today. It's this moment in Jesus' life, but I think the way of it is still available. That's very, very good news. And lastly, the Spirit brings life that continues past Jesus and into the life of his disciples. And this is a story from after Jesus' death on the cross, where Jesus actually gave out his last breath in order for the disciples to have this new experience of breath. And I'll read this story for you. Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you," stood among his disciples. After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." This title, Breath of Life, isn't just because it sounds cool. Like, it's here in the story of God. Jesus breathes on the disciples the breath of life, and that's what has them receive the Holy Spirit. This narrative is kind of crazy, right, in John. The breath of life is the beginning. Spirit descends in the life of Jesus, and now Jesus breathes his life on the disciples, on who will become the church. He says, "Receive the Holy Spirit." At this point, the Spirit won't hover over you. It won't just be far off or formless in your life. It won't even just animate your livelihood, this thing that we have just for being human, or descend on a moment, but we can actually receive the Spirit, to take in the Spirit. And this is a game changer. It means the Spirit can be present to us day in, day out, year in, year out, moment to moment. The Spirit can be here with us. What if we dared to believe that our lives could be better if the Spirit would be present to us, if we would receive the Spirit? I think it would be a game changer for us. I think there would be something new. There would be something that would mark that. One of the things helping convince me of that is this experience I'm having with a few other ECVers going to a women's Bible study that happens in a prison, the only women's prison in Connecticut. This Wednesday, in that kind of rush of constant movement, was actually kind of hoping embarrassingly for a lockdown, which means we wouldn't go. I'm like, okay, I want to go, but like I kind of want this to be canceled. You know, when you're waiting for a friend's text, like, I canceled this event. Like, yes. That was like where I was, except it was worse because it was a Bible study, and like I felt like I probably should be there. And that didn't happen, thank God. So we went. And this time, our Bible study started, I think, 6 weeks ago now with one person. This study had 27 women. Serenity is amazing. She's my co-leader. They asked, do we want women from this section of the prison or everyone? And without like a split second, I think it's actually supposed to maybe be one section. Serenity was like, everyone. And like, we got a lot more people. It was great. And one thing that's happening in that Bible study is I'm seeing people, I'm seeing these women hunger after something, like thirst after something. And it's reminding me, actually, wait, I think this is what I'm supposed to do. I think this is actually what's offered, really. We covered the Lord's Prayer, this prayer that Jesus teaches his disciples, our Father who art in heaven. We taught on this last December. And speaking about that, there's something that happened in the room where people said, I feel like I've like learned this prayer as a ritual, but like all of a sudden it's speaking to me and to my life right now. Like I don't know, like did you guys know who I am? Like what's going on? Like this is confusing. Like it's just scripture, but we're praying for the Spirit to come. And we got to that section about forgiveness, and that was just in that passage we read too. And forgiveness is something huge and real to us. And there's a lot of things there that have been done to those women that aren't right. There's a lot of things even in the prison as we struggle to see correctional officers treat those women rightly. And when we got to that passage, I just felt the room change. Suddenly, what was kind of open just was kind of like sucked inward. I don't have another way of describing it. But it felt like that forgiveness passage. Ooh, that was going to be a tough one. And we were going to end the Bible study by sharing the Lord's Prayer again, but it's leaving space between each line for people to pray. When we got to the lines about forgiveness, I just said, I don't want to kind of interrupt what's happening already, but I just want to pray, Holy Spirit, would you come and be present here? And just break off anything that's not of you. So I just prayed that prayer. And what the woman shared was just, I think, the depths of what was in them. I want to forgive, but I don't know how. God, help the person who hurt me. Be with them. I don't want to be with them, but you be with them. There was some shade in the prayers, but it was good prayer. And the room, these women that I don't think always necessarily get along outside, suddenly had become something like a family, like a support group. And the Spirit was present, moving with them, moving with us, making us one, giving us unity. I think some people actually really experienced the depths of forgiveness. And I know for me, I actually really understood what forgiveness really was and how I needed to re-up that and commit that. I couldn't just come in as a teacher and just be like, I know the answers. I was like, shoot, I need to forgive some people too. The Spirit brought life in this place of prison, in this place that doesn't seem like it could be life-giving, but the Spirit was there. The Spirit animated that place. And so we need to think, each one of us, what's a place in your life where you're not experiencing life? What's a place where you're like, it's just not there, Josh? And you've got to ask the Spirit, would you show me how you can bring life there? At this Bible study, we kind of go with this hard news, good news and hard news every week. There's good stuff here, but you're also still in prison, right? God's movement doesn't always mean that what we want to happen the most deeply goes away completely, but it might be God's movement coming to that hard place, being in that dark time, being in that lifeless place, but now there's more life there now. I think that's what I'm seeing, and it's teaching me a lot of things too. I want to end with just a few invitations that we have. The first is to be honest about where you need life. I kind of jumped the gun and said, where else? But let's actually be honest about ourselves. Where in your life do you need more life? Because the Spirit just doesn't change things on the outside. The Spirit changes things on the inside. That's one of the real benefits for Jesus leaving and the Spirit coming. That the Spirit changes us, our insides. So where in your life do you need more life? Where in your life are you experiencing that lifelessness, maybe that death or that dying? And where do you need the Spirit to come and to animate you? What is it? Reflect on that and then bring that to God. Actually ask the Holy Spirit to breathe on you. Seems like a strange thing. I think it might be strange. ask it if you're comfortable with. Holy Spirit, breathe your life on me. And then lastly, this is kind of a two-parter. Don't let your actions disqualify you from the Spirit. A lot of times we come into any space, but specifically religious spaces, and we feel like, oh, I'm already disqualified from this. I'm kind of here just to be polite, but like, I don't count, Josh. You don't understand that. But the Spirit actually does qualify you. The Spirit descends, right? Just like it descended with Jesus. It descends on us. You don't have to do things to go up to it. The Spirit comes down and will meet you wherever you are. So don't let your actions disqualify you. And at the same time, also learn to walk by the Spirit and to remain in the Spirit. And that happens as a day-by-day, step-by-step process. That's what we're going to be talking about in this series, how the Holy Spirit brings power, brings comfort, brings truth, unity, and joy. When the Holy Spirit reveals the Spirit to us, there's a way that we can see, oh, maybe I should walk a little differently. Maybe I should do things a little differently. The word repentance just simply means to change your mind. And the Spirit helps with that. Because the Spirit gives us new vision. I want to invite the worship team to come up. In worship today, I think we really have an opportunity to encounter the Spirit's presence, to let the music kind of enter us into a different space. It's one of the reasons why we use music in our worship. It kind of introduces us to a liminal space, a new space that's created. And we can kind of release more of who we are as we sing out, as we listen to music. Even as we're quiet, we can practice the presence of God and invite God's presence. We also are going to have prayer later on, and prayer is something that's empowered by the Holy Spirit. So we're going to have a time for you to bring your life, the real things going on in your story, even like the story I shared earlier, even your physical pains you might have in your body that you want to see God heal today. You can bring that and have the Holy Spirit bring life to you. And right now we're going to celebrate communion and mark communion. Because communion is that story of Jesus giving up his last breath, his very last breath, for us, out of love. Giving up his Spirit for the sake that one day we could experience his Spirit. We could encounter him through the Holy Spirit. Jesus had vision for why he went to the cross. And Scripture says, for the joy set before him. And I think a lot of that joy comes from knowing that we could experience his Spirit with God. The first time to be actually people of God's presence, people of God's Spirit. So in communion, we mark that time where the body of Jesus was up on that cross, bleeding, blood shed for us. That body is the bread of life. That blood is the juice that's represented here. And we take the body, the bread, and dip it into the cup, the juice, and we celebrate what it means to have a person that would give up their last breath so we could have a true one of ours, a breath that gives us life and brings us to God. So let me pray for us. Holy Spirit, would you breathe your breath of life over us, over each one of us? You know what that will do. You know where you're meeting people. I don't, but you do. So Spirit of God, would you come and have your way in each one of us? Would you encounter us with your presence? Would you be with us through your Spirit? God, would you take that labor that we've been walking in and participating in, and would you turn it into rest that comes from you? Rest from your Spirit.